said, it's my pleasure to welcome here our fellow from the Institute, Fabrizio Baldassarri, whom at last I will also hear speaking. I'm sorry I missed the previous talk last week. Fabrizio was very much talking last week too and this week as well. And his talk today is entitled How Much Living Bodies Fit, Descartes' Natural Philosophy, the Role of Botany. Fabrizio, in fact.
Okay, thank you very much, Dana. Thank you for giving me the possibility to be here. And my talk is How Much Living Bodies Fit, Descartes' Natural Philosophy, the Role of Botany. Of course, it seems an interesting question with many problematics related to role of life within Descartes' studies in general. But apparently, Descartes' mechanical reconstruction could... Apparently, Descartes' mechanical reconstruction could be used both to inert bodies and living bodies. So apparently, within Descartes' mechanization of nature, also living bodies could fit very well his natural philosophy. Because, as we know, Descartes' ontology is a mechanical ontology in which every body is reduced to a sort of mechanization. And we have to remember that also Descartes' method is a method, a mechanical method in some ways, because our knowledge of bodies is a sort of reconstruction of the internal structures of these bodies. And also Descartes' physics is a physics established on this matter as a whole, matter which has only one attribute, that is extension. And also his physiology reveals a sort of mechanization of functions. And so within these three features, according to these three features, living bodies, which displays especially the third one, a physiology of mechanical function, could be mechanically explained and could be part of Descartes' natural philosophy. Because living bodies are homogeneous to the other bodies. In fact, if we read one of the last articles of his Principia Philosophiae, in which his natural philosophy was described, Descartes said that he would have added the fifth part on living bodies, on animals and plants, and a sixth part on man, but he haven't added this part because he lacked some experiences. It seems at this point, at this stage, that Descartes was able to include living bodies within his natural philosophy. And he didn't for a mere empirical question, for a mere lack of observations. 3 years later, in 1637, in the letter used as preface to the French translation of the Principia, Descartes claimed the same things. He said, the structure of my natural philosophy started from metaphysics, and then we have a part on physics, a part on cosmology, a part on the bodies on the earth, but I can explain every body in the same way. And he wrote, in order to bring the plan to its conclusion, I should have to go on to explain in the same manner the nature of all the particular bodies which exist on the earth, namely minerals, plants, animals. So it seems that, according to Descartes, living bodies fit very well his natural philosophy. But what I'm going to discuss with you is another interpretation, because I consider this interpretation, the way that according to his mechanical ontology, living bodies fit very well his natural philosophy, I call this interpretation a reduction of living bodies of life on mechanics. And we will see that according to this reduction, we will face a sort of dissolution of life. In fact, there is a problem, because according to this interpretation, it's difficult to differentiate between inert and living bodies. In fact, according to this interpretation, an exhaustive definition of life is difficult to be found, and also the study of living bodies is not completely achieved, but also and especially a conception of living bodies in themselves appeared overlooked by Descartes. According to this interpretation, living bodies are automata. So there is no difference between a machine and an animal bodies. We have to remember, however, that Descartes dedicated to these studies a big part of his life. Medicine was counted as one-fifth of his entire work. And he concluded the Principia Philosophiae with a very interesting reconstruction of animal sensation, of the sensation of man, because animals, according to Descartes, did not display sensation, which is a mechanical reconstruction of the impulses of senses and how these impulses reach the brain, where through the pineal gland the mind could transform these mechanical impulses in sensation. On the other figure, we have an example of Descartes' botanical interest, because this is the second figure is not Cartesian, it's taken from Linnaeus. It is a Mimosa pudica, which is a plant who folds in wood and droops at the slightest contact with fingers. And at the epoch, it represented a sort of strange case, which Descartes reduced to rarity, because it displayed also what tradition have called an anima sensitiva, whereas plants were endowed with the anima vegetativa alone. But Descartes reduced the movement not to the presence of souls, so not to the presence of a vitalistic source of life, but to a mechanical origins. And he said that there is something in this plant that is also in animals. And actually, the study of living bodies is a really, really huge and important study. His first interest was registered in 1630s. And in 1630. And I think it is unlikely that Descartes started studying medicine before his second arrival in the United Provinces. I think his real interest in medicine and in living bodies and in physiology began in 1630. In a period in which he studied alchemy, chemistry, and anatomy at the same time, in a period in which he was aware of the fact that all bodies could be explained in the same way, in a period in which he was writing his physics. Physics he didn't publish in Le Monde. And he added to Le Monde L'Homme, which is a physiological reconstruction of bodily functions as a mechanical system. Even though both Le Monde and L'Homme are unaccomplished studies, because he refused to publish them because of Galileo Sabura, and he left this work aside. And when he returned on his natural philosophy, he produced a different natural philosophy. The Principia has a different structure from both Le Monde and L'Homme. But what is interesting in Lom is that even though Descartes claimed that he would explain the man in its entirety, so in its relating his bodily part, but also in the relationship between his bodily part and his mind, Lom presented only the first part. So it is a complete reconstruction of the body from a mechanical point of view. And what is interesting is what Descartes wrote to Mersenne, for example, in 1632. Je parlerai de l'homme et mon monde un peu plus que je ne pensais, car j'entreprends d'expliquer toutes ses principales fonctions. So he was trying to explain functions, bodily functions. J'ai décrit celles qui appartiennent à la vie, comme la digestion des viandes, le battement des poules, la distribution de l'aliment, les cinq sens. And he was also adding that he was anatomizing the head, the brain of animals in order to explain imagination, memory, and so on. In fact, Lom started with an interesting supposition. He said that his understanding of the body of animal and of man was identical, was similar to a statue or a machine. And a few lines after, he said that bodies are similar to clocks, to fountains, to machines in general. So his explanation of living bodies followed his explanation of machines, and he claimed that explaining machine would be the same to explain bodies in general and living bodies in particular. At this stage, a distinction between inert and living bodies appeared difficult because of this similarity between this comparison between machine and living bodies, so a comparison between automata and living bodies, but also because of Descartes' physics, which, as I was saying, was reduced to extended matter without essential differences. The only differences between bodies is a modal difference. So it depends on the construction between particles. In fact, in the Discours, which was published in 1637, Descartes once again did not distinguish between inert and living bodies from an essential point of view, but only from a methodological point of view. And at this point, he was claiming that he was unable to explain living bodies, the body of animals, in the same way in which he explained all the other bodies, because he needed something else. His method was not able to reach a complete explanation of animal bodies. But at this point, once again, there is no clear distinction between inanimate bodies, which are, I think, closer to which plants are closer, and animal bodies, so and living bodies. And also he said that he had no sufficient knowledge to speak about animal bodies in the same style of the rest of his physics, which means by demonstrating effect from causes. And this is a very important phrase in Descartes' economics of natural philosophy. Moreover, always in his discourse, Descartes said that there is no difference between the automata and living bodies, because he said that S'il y avait de telles machines qui usent les organes et la figure extérieure d'un singe ou de quelques autres animaux sans raison, nous n'aurions aucun moyen pour reconnaître qu'elles ne seraient pas en tout de même nature que ces animaux. So what Descartes is claiming at this point is that there is impossible to distinguish between an automata and an animal and a living body. The only difference is when the living body is connected to a mind. The only difference is in the fact that the man, for example, has the use of language. So we can recognize that this is not an automata because he can speak. That means because he has a mind which compose thoughts. And this is something he repeats to Mersenne in 1640, where he said once again that there is no difference, and it is extremely difficult to distinguish between automata and living bodies. However, Descartes tried to define a sort of principle of life within his explanation of bodies, which was in an extreme opposition to the explanation of life of the scholastic tradition. According to the scholastic tradition, according to the Aristotelian philosophy, life pertained to the soul. So each body who is living has a soul in itself. And there is a tripartition of souls. We have a vegetative soul, which is present in plants, a sensitive soul, which is in animals, and a rational soul, which is in man. Of course, man is composed of three of these souls, but which the man has not three different souls, but has one soul, which all of these three characteristics. And at the end of his L'Homme, Descartes claimed that his explanation of living bodies was perfect, especially because he didn't use souls. And he wrote, je désire dire que vous considérez que ces fonctions suivent tout naturellement en cette machine de la seule disposition de ses organes. Ne plus ne moins que font les mouvements d'un horloge ou autre automate, de celle de ses contrepoids et de ses autres. En sorte qu'il ne faut point à leur occasion concevoir en elle aucune autre âme végétative, ni sensitive, ni aucun autre principe de mouvement et de vie que son sang et ses esprits, agité par la chaleur du feu qui brûle continuellement dans son corps. So what Descartes is, and also the last line is important, et qui n'est point d'autre nature que tous les feux qui sont dans les corps inanimés. And this is important because also Aristotle claimed that in living bodies there is a source of heat. But according to the Aristotelian tradition, this source of heat was supernatural. Descartes is claiming that there is a heat in the heart, which is identical to the fire, so it's a natural heat. And his understanding of life and of living bodies at this point appeared reduced to the structure of organs and to a source of movement within the heart. And this is something he repeated to Boswell in 1646, Neque enim vita in moto musculorum consistit, sed in calore quest in corte. Life consisted in the heat within the heart, and something he repeated to Moore in 1649, vitam enim nulli animali denego, ut potem qua in solo cordis calore consistere statuum. And this is something it also brought in Le Passion de l'âme, which has been published in 1649, where he distinguished between a living body while it's living, le corps d'un homme vivant, and a living body while it's dead, le corps d'un homme mort, by the fact that this principle is no more present and the machine is not working. So it seems that within his career, because the car started studying medicine and life and physiology in 1630, and until 1649, the car will be dead in 1650. Until 1649, so during his life, his main understanding of living bodies was completely mechanical. But the problem is that, according to this interpretation, it's difficult to distinguish properly between living bodies and automata, for example, living bodies and inert bodies. Moreover, this distinction we have here between living and dead bodies is not essential, because as he had written in his Meditations in 1641, he claimed that this kind of interpretation of bodies through their work is a sort of external denomination. It's a denominatio extrinseca, which means that we could understand the work of bodies, but we cannot provide a complete principle, a complete explanation of why, of how these bodies work. And what is especially interesting is that according to this interpretation of life starting from the heat within the heart, we would have a reduction of the concept of life, because of course plants did not have a heart, so plants are not living bodies according to this interpretation. And also I think we are facing a dissolution of life. In fact, Descartes did not differentiate between inert and living bodies, and this principle of life appeared insufficient to the achievement of this explanation. What Descartes did exactly in his discourse, I think it is. We have to return on the page we read before, in which Descartes was saying that he had insufficient knowledge to speak of animal bodies in the same style of the rest. But at this point he was saying, as he had written in L'Homme, that he started from a supposition. Je me contentais de supposer que Dieu forma le corps d'un homme entièrement semblable à l'un des nôtres, tant en la figura extérieure de ses membres qu'en la conformation antérieure de ses organes, sans le composer d'autres matières que de celles que j'avais décrites, et sans mettre en lui, au commencement, aucune âme raisonnable ni aucune autre chose pouvait servir d'âme végétante ou sensitive, sinon qu'il excita en son corps un de ses feux sans lumière. So what Descartes is doing at this point, I think, is constructing two suppositions to underpin his explanation of living bodies. The first one is that bodies were equals. Entièrement semblable Alain de Notre for his external figures and his internal conformations of organs and composed of the same matter described in his physics. So this consists in the homogeneity between bodies, which was confirmed by Descartes' physics. So it's a supposition underpinned by principles. The second one is that there is an internal fire without light that activated life. But this presence was not underpinned by a supposition, by a principle, but was achieved through a direct experience. If we read a few pages later, Descartes wrote that ce mouvement, and he was explaining the circulation of blood, suit aussi nécessairement de la seule disposition des organes qu'on peut voir à l'œil dans le cœur, so through observation, et de la chaleur qu'on peut sentir avec les doigts. So this is an experience, according to Descartes' understanding of experimentation. So this this supposition, the second one, was underpinned by an experience. According to Descartes, I think we have to understand the role of experimentation in this point, because I think it is interesting in order to comprehend what Descartes was doing. According to Descartes, the role of the experience consisted of l'expérience rendant la plupart des effets très certains. So experience confirmed effects, and we can understand that it is exactly what he was doing with the living body. And he added something that is really interesting. Les causes dont je les déduis ne servent pas tant à les prouver qu'à les expliquer. Mais, tout au contraire, ce sont elles qui sont prouvées par eux. So, at this point, Descartes is adding something interesting, that we have causes and effects. Experience make effects clear. And effects are used to prove experiences, to prove causes or experiences, while causes are used to explain effects. So it seems that according to Descartes' construction of the relationship between causes and effects, we are completely on the side of effects, because he was using an experience to make the effect clear, and then he would be able to prove the causes starting from this effect. But at this point, this is something he did not achieve, because as he was continuing claiming that sometimes he started from supposition, which he could have deduced from le premier vérité, and so from principle of causes, but it's something he didn't do. So when he was trying to explain living bodies, Descartes was satisfied of a direct experience within these bodies, and tried to attain causes, but he was once again satisfied of claiming a supposition, of putting a supposition as a beginning of his entire explanation. So at this point, we know that Descartes was not interested in explaining, in describing the principle of life, but he was satisfied in describing the functioning of bodies. So in describing the effect these bodies will produce. The supposition that Descartes started from, the supposition for God created living bodies in the, as this, all the other bodies composed of the same matter and adding to these bodies heat, was encompassed within his methodological architecture. With, at this point, this architecture has as goal only to describe the heat within the earth, so to describe singular functions. And at this stage, Descartes appeared not interested in defining life, nor in distinguishing between inner and living bodies. At this stage, Descartes is interested in reveal a different physiology, a mechanical physiology of living bodies. So he was interested in describing, in defining bodies, living bodies, in the same way he had defined inert bodies, particular bodies. But this is extremely interesting, because it seems a sort of limitation to Descartes' research at this point. In 1637, the similitude between automata, clocks, for example, and living bodies, animals, was sufficient to Descartes' scope, which was to describe the physiology of bodies. And in 1637, Descartes was, in fact, not discussing about his principle of natural philosophy in general. So, the point is that Descartes' mechanical ontology and Descartes' mechanical physiology were useful, in, of course, but if we read through Descartes' texts, I think this ontology was useful only to achieve an explanation of singular functions, so only to achieve an explanation of physiology. But something else happens in 1637 and after the publication of the discourse. In fact, at the end of the year, his correspondence and the correspondence of his friends testified to Descartes' new interest in plants and in vegetation, in botany in general. And we have this letter from Ericus Reneri, which was one of the best friends of Descartes in the Netherlands, who joined Descartes in Saint Port during the winter holidays in order to make a few experiments on botany. And this is a letter he wrote to Mersenne in February of 1638, claiming that he was working with Monsieur Descartes, totus sum in observationibus facendis circa plantas et animalia. And also was saying that these observations were related to his use of lenses and to his use of microscopes, because he claimed that they had invented a sort of microscope. So in 1637 and 1638, Descartes and Reneri were working on plants and animals, putting plants and animals together, and also were observing plants and animals with microscopes. Mersenne, informed by Reneri, Mersenne in the summer of 1638 asked Descartes about the Mimosa pudica, which is called l'herbe sensitive, and Descartes reduced the the phenomenon of the mimosa pudica to a simple mechanical movement. But what is interesting at this point is that Descartes claims that the heat of the heart is the source of movement. Descartes is not claiming that this plant is alive, or the fact that the heat within the heart is a source of life to cool. But it seems that Descartes was reducing the heat of the heart, in this case, as a source of movement. And it seems that at this point he was moving from a definition of the heat within the heart as the principle of life to a more exhaustive understanding of life in general. So it was moving to a definition of the heat as source of life to something else, to a wider comprehension of life, in which of course the heat within the heart played an important role, but to which Descartes thought it was necessary to add something else. In fact, in this period, he was jotting down a few important and crucial notes, which has been published in the 19th century, and in which Descartes studied, in which Descartes recorded his studies with plants and with animals in particular. And Descartes was studying the role of this heat within living bodies, and the way these bodies form, construct themselves. In this note taken from the Prima Cogitazione circa generationem animalium, Descartes said that in animals there is a force of heat, a big calories, which moved particles and which in some ways operated in distinguishing between particles and produce life, first of all in the heart, and then the heart brought life within the whole body. In another interesting note taken, which is present both in the Prima Cogitationes and in the Excerpta Anatomica, Descartes said that the formation of plants and animals started from matter, in which there is a force of heat, an internal strength in some ways, and it is also distinguishes between plants and animals. He was saying that the particles of matter or in plants moved in a circular way, and at this point his explanation was that this happens because plants are grounded in the earth. So plants need to grow only in one way. Whereas animals, the particles of animals moved in a spherical way, because the body which grow within the womb of mothers grow in according to Descartes in a complete way. It's not connected to some part of the womb of the mother. So this is the Descartes explanation, in which, however, the heat played a very important, a very crucial role, which is problematic in some ways. So, because Descartes was claiming that this heat was the same heat which was present in inert matter as well. And in this note of the Principia Philosophiae, in which he was in a part in which he was discussing the way fire originates in inert bodies, in the, he reconstructs an incredible variation of cases. He said that fire could develop from stones, or could develop from particular bodies in particular aspect. In this article, Descartes said that it develops from the phenum, the plants which were cut and stored in some ways. So he said that the fire could develop. So he said, he was saying that fire was present also in plants which has been cut. So in plants which are dead. So it is claiming that there is a force, there is a heat which activated life within bodies, could be dangerous and difficult, because Descartes was claiming that there is also a heat, there is also a fire in dead bodies, because there is no difference between between fire. So we have to be really careful in understanding the principle of life through fire alone. And we should ask ourselves if there is any difference between a heat that constructs a body, as we have seen in the notes of the Prima Cogitationes and the Excerpta Anatomica, and a heat that corrupts a body, because the heat which develops in cut plants is a heat which is corrupting these bodies. It's not that life did not develop from this heat. And also we should ask ourselves if we want to continue through this line of claiming that life started from this heat, if there is a heat of different type, if exists a differentiation in nature. But this is something really, really dangerous, and this is something Descartes would not sustain, would not support. I think there is another explanation, especially because, of course, it's difficult to claim that there is an internal source alone which can provide life to bodies. Especially because, according to Descartes, natural philosophy, any force, the vis caloris had to be reduced to impact. So it is necessary to find something else to distinguish between inert and living bodies. And I think this happens in another note of the Excerpta Anatomica, in which Descartes was describing the growth of bodies in general. And he was distinguishing, and this is the only part in which Descartes provided this distinction, he was differentiating between dead bodies, and he was saying that are bodies which did not nourish themselves, but which are constructed by a position of parts, and metals, but also wood are transformed in stones in this way. So also fossilization was a sort of a position of particles, and he distinguished this way of growing, in which part came from outside the body and so composed the body, and another way of growing, the one of the living bodies, in which bodies nourish themselves, and in which part undergo a mutation within themselves. And if we read through this this note and the related notes of the Excerpta Anatomica, it is clear that from this distinction, Descartes was able to differentiate completely inert bodies, like stones, which are composed, of course, of the same matter and for which there is a heat, which of course helped in this composition, but this heat is outside the body, and also matter came from outside, and the composition of living bodies, so the and life, which consisted in, of course, once again, in matter, who arrived and joined a body, and of a source of heat. But in this, in the case of living bodies, either both matter and the heat are internal to the bodies. Of course, matter in living bodies came from outside because we nourish ourselves. But nutrition develops because there is a functioning within the living bodies. So what distinguishes living from inert bodies is the fact that there is there are functions which are related in some ways. And so I think that Descartes, in the Excerpta Anatomica, Descartes was achieving, of course he was explaining the functioning of plants and of animals, of living bodies in general from a mechanical point of view, was also claiming that the internal principle of life did not consist of the heat alone. So this heat had not a supernatural power, but life consisted of the arrangement, disposition of particles which composed organs. And so, through this composition, it was possible to distinguish between inert and living bodies because there is an organic cohesion within living bodies. According to Descartes, metals and stones in general, we can study metals and stone because of, and we can recognize that their composition consists only in a disposition of parts. While in living bodies, the composition of bodies depends of an organic cohesion, so of a functional unity within the living bodies. So even though there is a differentiation between Descartes' natural principle and this principle of life, I think there is a sort of, I think Descartes at this point was trying to find, to bridge this gap. So to understand living bodies through this organic cohesion of functionality from a mechanical point of view, making this understanding of living bodies mechanical. And even though it was once again reduced to the mechanical ontology from which we started, I think through this note it is possible to see that Descartes was trying to distinguish between bodies and explaining living bodies as an organic cohesion. which were of course consistent with his philosophy, but also which was able to provide a more exhaustive science of life. And so, to conclude, we started from a reductionist interpretation of bodies in general and of living bodies in particular, which was reduced to a mechanical ontology, in which life was lost. The concept of life was lost, and we could face a dissolution of life. But I think there is something else in Descartes, and if we want to study living bodies according to Descartes' studies and Descartes' natural philosophy, I think the second thread could be more useful, more important. It could reveal a sort of a reconciliation between his understanding of living bodies, to which Descartes dedicated the most important part of his life, and his natural philosophy. Thank you very much.
Right. Questions, reactions, objections. I have a kind of outside question. Was the distinction between living and non-living a clear cut distinction? I'm thinking now that, for example, Bacon is very much interested in organisms that you don't know exactly where to classify, like mushrooms and oysters and things.
Yes.
Was Descartes very clear on what is where life begins in this sense?
No, it's difficult because in this note, Descartes, these are very laboratorial notes in which Descartes was, in one point, was claiming that life began with when the heart is activated. In another point, he said that the heart is activated from disposition of the other organs, the liver and the brain, I think. And so life began in a different moment. So it did not provide a clear and definite definition of the origin of life. But it was interesting in the definition of this sort of paradox, like mushrooms, spoon, and so it was interesting according to him to understand if these bodies were alive or not, but it didn't provide any explanation about this. At one point, he also discussed the origin of life from dust, from garbage in general.
Like spontaneous generation,
but. Once again, it was not really clear. It seems something more that I know that this is a problem, but it was not facing this. According to what we have, probably there is something else in some libraries.
And heat was produced by collisions?
Yeah, this is interesting again, because at a certain point, he said that the heat activating the heart came from the blood of the mother. Mm-hmm. But this is, of course, a problem because he was saying that life started in the same way in plants. Mm-hmm. So where this heat came from? But it was not defining this. So I think that it was good. His idea is to claim that this heat produced life, activated life, because there is a disposition of parts, a disposition of organs, which develop in a coherent way. he was in another note, he was saying that in another note, in La Description du Corps Humain, which was a work he didn't publish, he claimed that we have the seed of plants, and from which the plants develop, but if we damage the seed, so if we ruin the disposition of particles within the seed, plants will not develop from this. So I think the heat played an important role, but it's not the only one for the development of life and for the definition of life.
Did he study the movement only in Mimosa pudica, or did he? I mean, Mimosa pudica is very relevant. You touch her, she moves. But did he study, if you know, did he study other plants and maybe movement, the movement of leaves via tropism, light tropism? You put a plant. You put a source of light, for example, and she will grow leaves on that part, or the leaves will fold, and that's still a movement, you cannot see it.
Probably. Yeah, no, he didn't study this. This is very interesting. No, he didn't study this, but he acknowledged that there is, of course, an internal movement of sap, of...
Okay.
And so, also, he reconstructed the growth of plants, the way plants develop different parts, and the way the different parts are composed, but always from a mechanical point of view. But at one point, in one note, he said that if you cut the branches in some part, or if you bend the branches in some ways, the plants develop higher. So, but
like a stimulus response, not only growth, but if you do something to it, it
yeah.
will respond, not immediately,
yeah.
but in time.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
that's
yeah.
the way plants
and,
respond.
And
yeah.
that means that the internal conformation of parts is changed.
Yeah.
Is that a new plant according to the definition? Or
No, I don't
so
know.
So it's not just the heat and the conformation of parts that plays a role, but other stimulus, if this is an example.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know if... No, I think it did not define this sort of differentiation between type of plants.
Mm-hmm.
But in another note, he claimed that if you cut one plant and if you put another plant on it, it will grow stronger and...
Was that only a supposition, or he did that experiment? Because
we don't know. He wrote about this, but I don't know if he did actually did this. Probably he didn't, but probably he was a friend with the director of the Leiden Botanical Garden, so probably he watched this at the Leiden Botanical Garden. We have no proof. It did not write, I'm doing this.
Yeah.
So it was not, it's not a direct experience by himself.
He's an armchair experimentalist.
But this is a reductionist point of view. He was healing Elizabeth as well.
Any other questions? Comments? Mitna? Nothing?
I was curious to hear more about the organic cohesion that you described at the very end, and how does it differ from a working mechanism of a clock, for instance?
Mm. That is a difficult question. I think the main difference consists in the fact in the page of the meditation where Descartes said that for automata we have only an external denomination. And I think in this note he was trying to provide an internal denomination of parts. So you can say that Abode is working not simply because you see it from outside, but because you know that in the inside the part, the organs of bodies are working in a cohesive ways. And through this definition, you can provide also a definition of illness, and then you can define therapeutics. This was my talk of last week, because if you consider the body like a clock, which could move in a correct way, even though it is damaged, because the clock could give you a correct hour, at least in 2 moments of the day, even though it is broken, even though it is stopped. This is an external denomination, so you cannot define the clock is not working unless you are the maker of this clock. And so this could work also for automata. So you know that, for example, it's not my case, but I could know when a laptop is not working and why it's not working. It's not my case because it's too difficult for me, but in the case of living bodies, he was trying to provide an internal function, so a functioning which was not understood only from an external eye, so not only from the eye of God, the eye of the Creator, but from a scientific point of view. And I think this could be the difference, and this could lead to the definition of organic coherence, an organic structure. But anyway, it is a very difficult point, because Descartes dedicated to this aspect only this note in his manuscript. So we have to extract through this note these features.
Huh? If that's it, we can move it over discussion over a glass of beer and continue to discuss more. I have a question that is probably more for the beer time than for beer, but what about parrots? Is the only way to distinguish between
it's interesting. Yeah, the fact is that parrots repeat words in a mechanical way, so they repeat what they listen, but only from a mechanical.
Some people do that too.
Some people do that too, but this you cannot claim in Cartesian terms, because at the beginning of his discours de la méthode, he said that our soul is equal in every man. So even the man with a very poor mind, he has the same soul of everyone else. The difference is because we have cultivated our mind in a different way. And this is because I can understand the cat, but I cannot understand the computer. I'm not too stupid in Cartesian terms.
Okay, thank you, Fabio.